Middle East. Masharif al-Awsat. Hamzra Hatihon. Khaver Miyane. Orta Doğu. One of the most striking things about the Middle East is that the past and the present seem to be all jumbled up together. One minute you're surrounded by buildings and highways that are as up to date as anything in London or New York. And then you turn the corner, and suddenly you're back in the Middle Ages. East, ancient and modern. And the new face is very new indeed. It only dates back about 20 or 30 years to the beginning of the oil boom. Up until the 1950s or thereabouts, the word that came to mind most often when you visited the Middle East was medieval. And even today, there are still many parts of this region that make you think you've walked onto the film set of an historical drama. You imagine that this is how the streets of almost any town must have looked 700 years ago, not just in the Middle East, but in Europe as well. Because in medieval times, Europe and the Middle East were very similar. In a sense, they formed a single community. But then there was a parting of the ways. The Europeans had their Renaissance, which triggered off a series of scientific and industrial revolutions that enabled them to surge ahead of the rest of the world. But why didn't the Middle East have an industrial revolution? After all, the great Islamic civilization that flourished during the Middle Ages made tremendous progress in science and technology. The European Renaissance itself owed a lot to the Muslims. But just as Europe was being reborn, the Middle East seemed to be, if not actually dying, at least to be falling asleep. Why? Why did the Middle East start to stagnate just at the very moment that Europe started to take off? There are many possible reasons. Some of the most important ones are economic. At the end of the Middle Ages, agriculture was still the main source of wealth, both in the Middle East and in Europe. But the Europeans were only just beginning to exploit their millions of acres of lush meadows and forests, whereas most of the Middle East had already become almost as barren as it remains today, consisting largely of sand and rock. In the 13th century, something like 80% of Europe was arable, as compared with about 5% of the Middle East, mainly confined to various parts of Turkey and Iran, plus narrow strips of fertile soil along the coasts of North Africa and the Fertile Crescent. How did the landscape of the Middle East become so barren? Was it just because of the hot, dry climate? Largely, yes. And yet we know that in ancient times, some parts of the region had been a lot more fertile. After all, agriculture itself, like so many other things, was invented in the Middle East some 10,000 years ago along the banks of the River Jordan. It's here that the very earliest evidence of the cultivation of wheat and barley has been found, near the town of Jericho, where you can still see ruins that date back to at least 7,000 BC. This makes Jericho the oldest continuously occupied settlement in the world. The Middle Easterners not only invented farming at the very dawn of history, but they also did very well from it. In some areas, abandoned wells and terraces and villages show how much more heavily cultivated much of the region used to be. One of the most spectacular examples of this is the ancient city of Petra in Jordan. From about 300 BC to 100 AD, Petra was the capital of the kingdom of an ancient Arabian people known as the Nabataeans. Petra was an important trading center, surrounded by orchards and wheat fields, and boasting a population of at least 30,000 people. Today, it's just a magnificent pile of rock in the middle of the desert. In fact, there's almost no part of the Earth's surface that's been so denuded as the Middle East. Between the time of the invention of agriculture in Jericho and the coming of the Middle Ages, the Middle Easterners destroyed about 90% of their forests. That sounds terrible, but after all, we're talking about a period of over 9,000 years. In North America, just in the last 150 years, we've destroyed more than 60% of our own forests. So one reason why the economic initiative passed to Europe at the end of the Middle Ages was agricultural. The Middle East was worn out, whereas the vast forest lands of Europe were still uncleared. But the erosion of the soil of the Middle East was a very gradual process. Then, in the 13th century, a catastrophe struck the farming economy of the region, a catastrophe which was to put an end to the golden age of Islam. Let's go back to look at this period in a bit more detail. The heyday of the Muslims is usually considered to have run from roughly 700 to 1200 AD. At first, this Islamic empire is dominated by the Arabs. Then the Iranians begin to exert more and more influence. And then, by about 1000 AD, the Turks come into the picture. And wave after wave of Turkish nomads start to move into the Middle East from Central Asia. But even before then, the Arabs and the Iranians had purchased Turkish boys and trained them to be slave soldiers. They had become known as owned men, or Mamluks in Arabic. But gradually, both these Mamluks and Turkish nomads gain more and more political power, and they split the Islamic world into a number of different dynasties. And the final blow comes in the 13th century, when a much more destructive wave of Mongolian and Turkish nomads gathers momentum in Central Asia under the leadership of Genghis Khan, whose conquests in Asia extend into Afghanistan and Iran, and whose grandson, Hulagu, pushes further into Iraq, Turkey, and Syria. The armies of Genghis Khan and Hulagu overthrow the centers of power in many parts of the Middle East, slaughtering millions of people in a calculated policy of rule by terror. This culminates in the destruction of the city of Baghdad in 1258, a date which has traditionally been taken as marking the end of the golden age of Islam. The economy of large areas of the Middle East never completely recovered from these conquests by the Mongol nomads, who not only massacred people and devastated cities, but also demolished, or simply neglected, many of the farms and irrigation systems in the region. To a certain extent, the medieval Middle Easterners were able to recuperate from this disaster by reconsolidating their position as the trading hub of the world. They continued to control almost all the traffic between East and West, especially in silks and spices and precious metals. But as Europe grows more powerful economically, the Europeans look for ways to outflank the Middle Eastern traders, to find a direct sea route to India, which bypasses the Middle East altogether. This is to lead to two momentous events, which are to change the whole course of history. In 1492, Christopher Columbus, while looking for a new route to India, discovers America. And just 6 years later, Vasco da Gama, who was also looking for a new route to the east, actually succeeds in finding it by sailing around the southernmost tip of Africa and landing on the west coast of India in 1498. Now, it's difficult to exaggerate the importance of what Columbus and da Gama did. They changed the face of the world. For thousands of years, the Middle East had been at the center of everything. All the lines of force of culture and economics had converged on this crossroads of civilization. But then all this energy starts to be deflected into two quite new directions. One line of force shooting off westwards from Europe to the New World, and another line of force veering south and east from Europe, linking it with India and China. This will eventually leave the Middle East in limbo, a backwater, cut off from the main economic and cultural currents of the world. One immediate result of the discovery of America is the almost simultaneous discovery of enormous quantities of silver and gold, which soon flood the world's money markets and cause a sharp devaluation of the precious metals in the Middle Eastern treasuries. And of course, at the same time, the route around Africa to the Far East drastically reduces the flow of goods through the Middle East. So the Middle East gets left behind, stuck back in the Middle Ages. First, because most of its agricultural land is exhausted. Second, because of the havoc wrought by the Mongols. And third, to top it all, because it's now bypassed by new trade routes which minimize its historic role as a commercial crossroads. The result? Economic stagnation, which will settle over the Middle East for the next 400 years, from the beginning of the 16th century until the beginning of the 20th. But here we come to an apparent contradiction, because these four centuries happen to coincide almost exactly with the period in which nearly all of the Middle East is under Ottoman rule. And it's in the first two of these centuries, the 16th and the 17th, that the Ottomans enjoy their greatest military success. They win battle after battle, not only in the Arab lands of the Middle East, but also in Southeast Europe. But if the Ottomans were so successful on the battlefield in the 16th and 17th centuries, how can we say that this period was one of stagnation? Because the Ottoman economy was basically not very productive. Only the continual taking of booty and occupying of new land disguised this fact. The Ottomans failed to realize this, as they also failed to realize that they couldn't go on defeating the Europeans forever. And the reason for this was that the Ottomans had a very low opinion of the Europeans. After all, the last Europeans who had tried to invade the Middle East had been the Crusaders. And in Muslim eyes, the whole Crusader episode had proved not only that the Europeans could be vanquished in battle, but also that they were culturally inferior. It's true that the Crusaders had managed to capture the Holy Land in the 12th century, but they were progressively beaten back and eventually driven out of the Middle East once and for all in 1291. While they were in the Middle East, the Crusaders made a very poor impression on the Muslims. In the West, the word Crusader conjures up images of knights in shining armor. But in reality, most of these people were barbaric by Muslim standards, and they were extremely cruel. They slaughtered tens of thousands of Muslims and Jews in the Holy Land in a manner worthy of Genghis Khan. So the much more civilized Muslims rightly considered the Crusaders to be little more than a bunch of savage infidels from darkest Europe. This rather squalid image of the Europeans stayed with the Muslims right into the 17th century Ottoman Empire. Although by now, of course, it was dangerously out of date. Military victories had created a fool's paradise for the Ottomans, and this paradise was only made more alluring by all the Turkish delights of their palaces and harems, which further insulated many of the Ottoman sultans from what was going on in the outside world. The crunch came in 1683, when they were soundly defeated by the Europeans after their second unsuccessful siege of Vienna. This was one of the first in a long series of setbacks in Europe, which continued throughout the 18th century. And right at the end of that century, the unthinkable happened. For the first time in 500 years, a European army successfully invaded the heart of the Middle East itself, when Napoleon landed in Egypt in 1798. The ease with which Napoleon subdued the Turkish forces in Egypt suddenly shocked the Middle Eastern rulers into realizing for the first time just how superior Europe had become. But the shock was mutual, and it jolted the Europeans into realizing just how inferior the Middle East had become. So although Napoleon's invasion of Egypt did stimulate the Middle Easterners to set in train a series of modernizing reforms, it also stimulated the Europeans, chiefly the British and the French, to take control of as much of the region as they could. And this imperialism tended to cancel out the reforms, because it simply wasn't in the interests of the imperialists to let the Middle East develop too independently. This is one of the main reasons why throughout the 19th and the first half of the 20th century, most of the attempts at modernization in the region were very superficial and patchy, having little effect on the great mass of the population. Although the economy of the Middle East did gradually recover, it was now under European control. And it was the Europeans who were reaping nearly all the benefit. For a long time, the Middle Easterners lacked the ability or the confidence to do anything about this. But modernization eventually had an impact, and slowly their confidence returned. By the end of World War II, most Middle Eastern countries had achieved some degree of independence, and more Middle Easterners were taking charge of their own affairs. This process was accelerated by the vastly increased oil wealth that began pouring into the Middle East in the 50s and 60s. But it wasn't until the 1970s, when Iran and the Arab oil-producing countries began to make massive increases in their oil prices, that things really heated up. Over the last dozen years, the modernization of the Middle East has taken off at a breakneck pace. It's brought about unprecedented changes, which have catapulted many parts of the region from the Middle Ages into the modern era almost overnight. Hence the incredible contrast that we now see between the ways of the fathers and the ways of the sons. The Gulf states, for example, have now become very wealthy from the export of oil. But only a generation ago, their main export consisted of pearls. Which were harvested at the cost of enormous danger and hardship, using primitive techniques dating back to the Bronze Age. Today, the sons of these pearl divers are studying computer science or nuclear physics at the new Gulf universities. From pearls to protons. A generation gap that spans the history of the world.